Good afternoon, everyone, and a very warm welcome to all of you for this inter-house quiz final at St. Kabir with a bunch of very bright grade 8 students who have all come through a preliminary round and qualified to represent their respective houses. So welcome once again. This should be a fun and interesting quiz. Some of you may have seen past Nexus quizzes that have happened, including the Pantomathics inter-school quiz competition that St. Kabir had organized, which I was privileged enough to host. This one's internal, so it should be, I always feel that internal contests are a lot more engaging and a lot more fun, a lot more competitive spirit over there. So let's see how it goes. So let's get rolling with the quiz. The quiz is, of course, brought to you by us at Nexus Consulting. We've been associated with St. Kabir for a year now. Many of you may be going through our GK program in your schools, and we do several interesting events and content for schools, colleges, corporates, and media. Look us up on our social media platforms when you have time. And my name is Venki. I'm your host for today. All right. So let's meet the finalists. So we've arranged you in alphabetical order. So when your name comes up, just say hi and introduce yourself. Tell us if you've quizzed in the past and so on. So our contestant number one in today's final is Aditya Goyal, representing Orchid House.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Aditya, just say hi and say something about yourself.
I'm Aditya Goyal of class 8A.
Okay, have you taken part in quizzes before, Aditya?
Yes, sir. I have taken part in science quiz.
Okay.
Which was also inter-house.
Okay, fantastic. All the best to you. Let's move on. So remember your numbers. Number two today is Anvi Garg from Tulip.
Hello, everyone. I'm Anvi Garg from class 8C, and I have taken part in some quizzes before.
Okay, welcome, Anvi. Moving on, at number three is Bhavik.
Hi everyone, I'm Bhavik Karoda, and I have also taken part in many quizzes.
All right. Number four is Chinmay.
Hello everyone, I'm Chinmay, and I've also taken part in many quizzes.
All right, Chinmay, welcome. Looks like a lot of people here are quite experienced quizzers, if I can say that, even if you're in grade 8. Well and good. Let's move to the second half. Number five, we have Karmanpreet.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Karmanpreet Kaur, and I am from 8A. I am representing Violet House. I have taken some quizzes before also.
All right. Very good. Welcome, Karmanpreet. Moving on to number six, which is Sankarshan.
Very good afternoon to everyone. I am Sankarshan, and I am representing Tulip House. And I have taken part in two or three GK quizzes before.
Very good. Welcome, Sankarshan. So we have a keen contest going on. Orchid, Tulip. Okay, Sarakshi from Orchid.
Good morning, everyone. I am Sarakshi Sharma, and I'll be representing Orchid House. And this is my first quiz.
Okay, welcome, Sarakshi. Good to see somebody in their first quiz. Hope you have a lot of fun. And last but not the least, as number eight, we have Sifat.
Hello everyone, I'm Sifat Sethi, and I'm representing Daffodil House today. This is my fourth quiz.
All right, welcome. Great. So we have Orchid, Tulip, Violet, and Daffodil. Close contest beckons. Let's go straight in and see what the rules are. There are three rounds in the quiz. Here's round number one. Round number one is called round the clock, which means we have 12 questions. We go clockwise, starting from Aditya as number one. And the questions move on in clockwise order, Aditya, Anvi, Bhavik, and so on, all the way up till Sifat. 10 points per correct answer, no negative marking. If there are part points, if there are two parts to a question, part points will be awarded. There is a concept of infinite bounds, which means the question starts with Aditya. If he doesn't answer, moves to Anvi. And let's say Bhavik answers it. Question number two will not go back to Anvi. It will go to Chinmay, right? So like the person who answers it, the next person will get the next direct question. This way, the questions are completely randomized. One important rule, we would like you to, it's obviously an internal quiz. We'd like you to play fair. So please keep your hands in front of camera like this, on or near your chins at all points of time. There is no typing to be done at all. There is no writing, typing, nothing. All answers are to only be given on the mic. Keep yourself on mute. Keep your video on all the time. Keep yourself on mute unless it is your turn to take part to answer. When it's your turn to answer, just unmute and make a guess, right? Play fair, no Googling, etc. Right. So with that, let's get started. Here is, so request everybody to stay on mute so that we can have no disturbance while the questions are being asked. All right. So first question of the final goes to Aditya. Here it is. Okay. We're going to show you a picture. This is a photo taken on 30th March, 2011. In it, you can see then Prime Minister of India, Dr. Manmohan Singh, with the then Prime Minister of Pakistan. What sporting event are they both watching very keenly? And where exactly was this photo taken? So for where, you can tell me, like, you can give me a town or a city or a very specific location if you wish to. Okay, let's see the picture. So this is the picture. You can see right in the middle, you can see the then prime ministers of India and Pakistan sitting together. And you can also see some other familiar faces. You can see Mrs. Sonia Gandhi over there and so on. They are keenly watching a sporting event that happened on 30th March 2011. Right? So that date is quite important. So what are they watching? And where was this photo taken? Question to Aditya.
Sir, this is a photo of semi-final World Cup of India versus Pakistan, and it was held in Punjab, Mohali.
Semi-final of what World Cup?
So, cricket.
So your answer is semi-final of the cricket World Cup, India versus Pakistan. And where was it held?
Some Mohali.
Mohali. Great answer. Great answer. Absolutely right. Good start, Aditya. Absolutely correct. This is the famous India-Pakistan 2011 World Cup semi-final, which was held at the Punjab Cricket Association IS Bindra Stadium in Mohali. Of course, a historic win for India in this match. And then they went on to win the final as well and lift the trophy under MS Dhoni's captaincy. So great answer. Good start. 10 points. So local question to begin with, Mohali. 10 points to Aditya. Question now goes to Anvi. Anvi, recent presidential elections, you must have been watching the news. This US state saw tightly contested elections with Joe Biden becoming the first person from his party, the Democratic Party, since 1992 to win the state in the presidential elections. The state incidentally shares its name with another country, and that country's capital is Tbilisi. So name the state or the country. The country is obviously a different country and it's in a different continent as well. So both have the same one word name. We've given you some of the important cities in this US state: Albany, Savannah, Augusta, and Atlanta. Tell me which state or country this is. This is one of the most keenly contested states in the recent US elections, which, as you all know, Joe Biden won and has been certified to be the next president of the US, 46th president.
I really don't know. I can just guess.
Yes, go ahead.
Canada.
Canada. Okay. No, not Canada. Passing you to Bhavik. So the name of the state is the same as the name of a country in a different continent.
Yeah.
Yes, Bhavik, you have a guess?
Is it Florida?
Florida. Nice guess. Not Florida. Passing you to Chinmay.
Sir, I think it's Georgia.
Georgia is the right answer. Good answer, Chinmay. It is indeed Georgia. That is correct. So this is the state of Georgia. And Georgia also, if you read the news recently, had a very close Senate election that happened that decided who would take control of the US Senate. And Georgia, of course, is also a European country. There you can see bordering Russia, Turkey, Armenia, and so on on the Black Sea. So that's Georgia. Well done. So that's both the country and the state named after King George of the United Kingdom, the former King of the United Kingdom. 10 points to Chinmay. Question, therefore, direct now goes to Karmanpreet. Karmanpreet, when this organization was formed in 1987, it had 7 countries as members. One more country, which is also in the same geographical area, wanted to join, but they were allowed only in 2007 after this country conducted elections, to their parliament. So which organization is this? It's an organization that is made up originally of 7 countries, and now it is made up of 8 countries after one more country was finally admitted in 2007 after elections were conducted. So what you see in the middle in orange kind of color, saffron color, is the logo of the organization, and kind of around it you can see the flags of the various countries that make up the organization being represented in some way. So which organization and which country is the latest entrant to this organization? Question to Karmanpreet. Again, half points if you get one part correct, which I will not be revealing. I will be revealing that once the question is complete and somebody gives me a full answer. Yes.
Sir, I am guessing the country must be Japan.
Japan, okay. And the organization?
Sir, I don't know.
You don't know. Okay. Let's pass it on to Sankarshan.
So the organization, I think it is of, it is Central Africa.
Okay. Central Africa something. And which country?
And the country is Kenya.
Kenya. All right. Nice guess. Not Central African Association and Kenya. Passing on to Sarakshi.
The organization is SARC and the country is Afghanistan.
And what is SARC?
South Asian Association.
South Asian. Yeah, that's all I wanted. Good answer, Sarakshi. Absolutely right. This is indeed SARC, South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation. And the 8th member state is Afghanistan. The other member states are Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. So well done. That's a good 10 points to Sarakshi there on SARC and Afghanistan, South Asian Association. Very important in the context of South Asia becoming South Asian countries becoming increasingly economically upward and powerful and so on. All right. Next question to Sifat. Sifat, these objects in our solar system are actually named A, B, C, D, E, F, and G in the order in which they were discovered. The spacecraft named Cassini has had a very good look at them over the past few years and has taken many photos. What are these objects? There is a nice clue in the fact that they are named A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. What are these objects? Objects in the loose sense of the term, but something that you all know very well. Question with Sifat.
I really don't know the answer to this question, but I can guess.
Yeah, make a guess. That's the whole joy of quizzing. Make a guess.
I think they're meteoroids.
Okay, meteorites. Okay, nice guess. Not meteorites. Passing to Aditya.
Sir, I think it's rings of Saturn.
And how did you figure out that it's rings of Saturn?
Sir, actually this spacecraft orbited around the planets, and it one of the planets were also Saturn.
That is good. And you can see that A to G is actually 7, and there are 7 rings of Saturn.
Yes, sir.
So very nicely done, Aditya. That is the right answer indeed. You get 10 points for that. This is the rings of Saturn, right? So there are actually seven rings and named A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. And then there is a Cassini division and an NK division. And like Aditya said, the spacecraft Cassini was actually sent to orbit Saturn and take photographs of Saturn. And it took some really stunning photographs of the rings of Saturn that you've heard of, right? Originally kind of discovered by, you know, famous astronomers, including people like Galileo had a role to play. All right, let's move on to Anvi. Anvi, in 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, the famous novel by Jules Verne, the Nautilus goes underneath a real-life structure that was being built at that time. Right? You have to remember that this novel was written in the 1800s. Jules Verne says that the nature had built a natural alternative underwater. The real-life structure was built and designed by the Frenchman Ferdinand de Lesseps, and it helped make travel time between Europe and India very short. What real life structure are we talking about? A very important one in the world, which made travel time and therefore trade and commerce between Europe, Africa, and India very short. And in the novel 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, the submarine Nautilus actually goes underneath this structure. So what are we talking about? We're looking for a two-word answer here.
I don't know, and I'm not able to guess something.
Take a guess. What do you think could be a structure that would be built, on water and made? What kind of a structure would end up making travel times very short and so on?
I don't know this one.
Okay, no problem. We'll pass you on to Bhavik.
I guess it's a cape.
It's a what?
Cape.
Cape. Okay, nice try. Not a cape. Chinmay?
I don't know.
You don't know? Okay. Passing you to Karmanpreet.
What's a lighthouse?
Lighthouse. Nice guess again. Not a lighthouse. Passing you to Sankarshan.
Sir, I think it is the Suez Canal.
That is a good answer, Sankarshan. Absolutely right. It is indeed the Suez Canal. Right? So the Suez Canal kind of ended up, you can see the route, from to Asia from Europe. Earlier, it had to kind of go all around Africa through the Cape of Good Hope and then, reach Southeast Asia, whereas the Suez Canal kind of cut that time and the distance down dramatically, improved trade significantly, and became a very important strategic kind of structure. And Jules Verne actually says that there is an underwater natural alternative to the Suez Canal. In his book, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. If you haven't read it, a fascinating book that you must read. Okay, that's a good 10 points to Sankarshan on that. Everybody, lots of people have opened their account, which is good. So let's move to Sarakshi for the next question. So you're direct. Sarakshi, simple one. This purple-blue element is used as a medicine to treat wounds. It's highly effective in preventing infections and has been used for nearly 200 years now to treat various kinds of infections caused by bacteria, fungi, viruses, and so on. Very commonly found in clinics and hospitals and, so on today. So if you go to a hospital or an emergency room or a clinic, especially with a wound, this is something that you'll find over there. Simply tell us which element are we talking about. You find the element in a little bit of a processed form, but which element are we talking about?
Iodine.
Iodine is right. In what form will you find iodine typically? What is it called? Do you know when it's used to treat wounds? Sorry?
Iodine is usually found in liquid form.
Yeah, I know. But, it typically is called iodine something when it's used to treat wounds. It's okay. I'm going to give you the points anyway. The question was just which element. The element is iodine. It's iodine tincture, right? So you'll typically see iodine tincture, which is a first aid antiseptic that you'll find. If you have a wound and you want to go and get it cleaned and dressed, they'll first use iodine tincture on it. So this is iodine. Well done, Sarakshi. 10 points to you. Question now goes to Sifat. Sifat, this is an interesting question. This is a great American jazz musician called Charlie Parker. He was known by a famous nickname, a very simple one-word nickname, because of his melodious tunes. Now we are going to show you two album covers. Look at the album covers and try to work out his one-word nickname. Okay, let's see the album cover. So the first album cover, this is Charlie Parker, and the album title is Ornithology. Now it's important for you to know what ornithology means, right? The second album cover says Gets the Worm. Okay, the album is titled Gets the Worm. So using these two titles, Ornithology and Gets the Worm, tell us what is Charlie Parker's nickname, also given to him because of his melodious tunes. A very general one short word is all we're looking for. Little lateral thinking is needed, but you can get to the answer with the clues. Think about a famous, you know, the Get the Worm should remind you of something famous. Similarly, if you know what ornithology is all about, that should help you get to the answer. Okay, Sifat, you want to make a guess?
Sir, I can't give this answer. I'm not able to relate.
Okay, all right. We'll pass you on to Aditya.
Sir, I think it's bird. Okay. I've listed from the phrase, early bird gets the worm.
And ornithology is the study of?
Birds.
Birds, absolutely right. Well done, well cracked. Yes, that's how we were supposed to get to the answer. Ornithology is the study of birds, and early bird gets the worm is, of course, something that all of you have been taught and you've heard of. So this is, he was called Charlie the Bird Parker. So as simple as that. So the bird, good answer, Aditya. You're off to a good start. Three answers so far. Anvi, next question comes to you again. Let's see if you can open your account. Okay. Thomas Hancock was a man who pioneered rubber manufacturing. One of the things he came up with to show off his new process was a do-it-yourself kit. Until then, animal bladders were used to make something. The same objects made Hancock's kit last longer. It made people very happy, especially young kids. What did Hancock's kit make? An object that is commonplace today that you will always, you'll even today, if you give this object to young kids, or even slightly older kids, they will be happy with it. So very simply, one word answer again. What was Thomas Hancock's kit used to make? So originally it was made out of using animal bladders and so on. He pioneered the way of making it with rubber. Something that young kids would happily play with.
I think rubber bands are made of rubber, but I don't think that's the answer.
Okay. Keep thinking on the same lines. Think about something that you have also definitely used or played with as a kid. Possibly, you know, this is something you see or use once in a while, even today. Typically, at least once a year, you may be kind of, you know, people might be using this or playing with it. Or
I don't know this one, I guess.
Make a guess. Don't pass. Make some guess.
Toy.
A toy. You have to give me some specific name, like a specific type of thing.
No, I don't know this one.
Okay, no problem. We'll pass you to Bhavik. be quick on the pass, guys. So, you know, we're giving a lot of time for the people who are answering it direct. So we'll do it a little more quickly on the pass.
Sir, I will pass. I don't know.
Okay. Quickly passing on to Chinmay.
Sir, me too.
You're also passing. Passes on to Karmanpreet.
Sir, I think Clay.
Clay, not Clay. Good guess. Passing it on to Sankarshan.
Can I tell one more?
No, sorry. Only one guess per participant. Sankarshan?
Sir, I think it's Lego.
Lego, not Lego. Sarakshi?
It's like, is it the honey nipple or honey toy?
Nope. Passing to Sifat. It's a much simpler answer than all this.
I even guessed a Lego.
You are also guessing Lego, is it? You want to? Okay. Passing you on then to Aditya.
Sir, I have no guess actually.
Make some guess quickly.
Pass.
Oh, okay. I thought this will be the easiest question. All of you have answered all the tough questions so far and missed what I think is the easiest question. Let's see if any of the teachers or the others attending want to attempt.
Sir, may I?
Yeah, who was that? Somebody wanted to take a second guess?
Sir, Mehul.
Yeah, okay. Mehul, what's the answer?
Sir, I think it is a balloon.
Balloon, as simple as that, absolutely right. It is just balloons. So till then, balloons were made of animal bladder, and then he just came up with a kit where you could easily make balloons from rubber. So as simple as toy balloons or balloons. Okay, that one seems to have stumped everyone. Let's go to the next question. Anvi had the last direct, so this one goes to Bhavik. Bhavik? The man in the picture, a famous scientist called Norman Borlaug, was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1970. His citation reads, "For his contributions to the ... that had such an impact, particularly in Asia and Latin America." Fill in the blanks with a two-word colorful phrase that all of us are familiar with. Look carefully at the picture, look at what he's holding, and something that he did had a massive impact in Asia, especially India and in Latin America. What is the two-word phrase for whatever he kind of pioneered? Again, a phrase that you've definitely come across in your, likely come across in your school books and so on. And we've given you an additional clue saying it's a colorful phrase, which means one of the two words in the phrase is a color. Time for Bhavik to make a guess.
Sir, the yellow wheat.
Yellow wheat. Okay. Good thinking, but wrong answer. Chinmay? Chinmay, you have a guess? No? Okay, Karmanpreet?
With flying colors.
Sorry?
Flying colors.
Flying colors. No, not flying colors. Sankarshan?
Sir, I had go with yellow maize.
Yellow maize. Okay. Sarakshi?
Revolution.
Green revolution is the right answer. Absolutely right, Sarakshi. Good answer. Green revolution. Right? All of you were saying the right things in terms of maize and wheat and so on. He was indeed holding up, grains of rice over there. But the point was that this whole thing was called the Green Revolution. Right? He introduced these new strains of wheat and rice and dramatically was able to increase crop productivity and It is said that many countries, including India, were able to overcome their shortage of crops and address issues of hunger and poverty because of the Green Revolution, right? The Indian counterpart was another famous scientist called Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, who worked closely with Norman Borlaug to come up with this Green Revolution. So it is called Green Revolution because it obviously resulted in a dramatic increase in the productivity of crops and so on. So well done. 10 points to Sarakshi there. Question to Sifat. I think it's the penultimate question of the round coming up. Okay, 10th question. It stands on a pedestal in the Kremlin and is the largest bell in the world. What is the name of this 202-ton monster bell? It's again a one-word answer. It is a title that was taken by the rulers of Russia and is derived from the Latin word Caesar.
So I've read about this somewhere. This is the Tsar bell.
This is the Tsar bell indeed. Well done, Sifat. Absolutely right. Reading always helps. This is indeed the Tsar bell, right? So the Tsar bell and the Tsars of Russia. Well done. Sifat is off the mark. 10 points. Question to Aditya. Penultimate question of clockwise. Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great encouraged his men to shave their heads and proceeded to do so himself. This was despite Greek leaders traditionally growing beards. It was a move made not for hygiene or appearance's sake, but was a well-thought-out battlefield strategy. Why did Alexander apparently ask his men to shave their beards? It's a very interesting, very workoutable kind of answer. So it was not for the sake of hygiene. It was not for the sake of, you know, looking smart or looking good or whatever, but it was a well-thought-out battlefield strategy. So why did he ask his soldiers to shave their beards? Question is with Aditya.
Sir, so that nobody can hold them from their beard.
Nobody can hold them from their beard in what context?
Sir, I'm audible.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, I am saying so that nobody can hold them from their beard in the war.
In the war when, you mean when they are fighting?
Yeah.
Okay. So you are saying when they are fighting close to each other, nobody can hold them by their beards.
Yeah.
That's the perfect answer, Aditya. Well done. Nicely worked out. So that enemies couldn't grab their beards during close fighting. That is as simple as that. Well done. 10 points to Aditya there. And the last question of the clockwise round goes to Anvi. Anvi, simple and straight question. In 1988, the Indian Postal Service released this commemorative stamp on the 150th anniversary of a famous newspaper in India. Who is the character seen on the stamp and which newspaper are we talking about?
Newspaper, I can guess the newspaper. I guess it's Hindustan Times.
The Hindustan Times, okay. And who is this character?
Character, I don't think he's some prime minister. I think he's no, I don't know this one.
Okay. Bhavik?
Yes, sir. I think this is Mahatma Gandhi and the newspaper is the Times of India.
Mahatma Gandhi and the Times of India. Okay. Passes to Chinmay. Chinmay, quickly. Chinmay passing?
Yes, sir.
So the character maybe
no, wait, hold on. Let me pass it on from him. Okay. Yes, Karmanpreet, it is your turn now. Go ahead.
The character maybe R.K. Lakshman because he made cartoons characters, and the newspaper maybe Times of India.
I don't need the name of a person. I need the name of a character. You are giving me the name of a real life person. R.K. Lakshman and said he made various cartoons. I need the name of a character. So I'll give you, since you said something, I'll give you a chance to modify it a little bit. Karmanpreet?
Advani.
Sorry?
Advani.
No, passing you on to Sankarshan.
Sir, the newspaper is Times of India and the character is Chacha Chaudhary.
Chacha Chaudhary. No, it's not Chacha Chaudhary. Passing you on to Sarakshi.
The newspaper is Times of India and the character is The Common Man by R.K. Lakshman.
Perfect answer, Sarakshi. Absolutely right. This is indeed R.K. Lakshman's The Common Man. And the newspaper, you could pretty much almost see the name in his hand of the paper he was holding. It is the Times of India indeed. So 5 points to Bhavik, who opens his account for saying Times of India. And the full 10 points to Sarakshi for saying Common Man and Times of India. All right. So I think that brings us to the end of the first round. Let's do a quick check on the scores. Venkat, I have the scores. I'll announce them. If you have a discrepancy, just let me know. All right. So we have two people, Anvi and Karmanpreet, who are yet to open their account. We have Bhavik on 5 points. We have Chinmay and Sifat. Chinmay, Sankarshan and Sifat all on 10 points. Currently in joint third place. And in the lead jointly at this moment are Aditya and Sarakshi with that last answer. Both of you are on 40 points. Okay. Venkat, is that correct?
Hello, yeah, it is it.
All right, okay. So repeating once again, Aditya 40, Anvi yet to open, Bhavik on 5, Chinmay on 10, Karmanpreet yet to start, Sankarshan on 10, Sarakshi on 40, Sifat on 10. Okay, let's go to the next round. Next round is called Pick Your Gambit, right? So you are going to see a grid with various topics. You can pick a topic of your choice. You'll get a question. Unanswered questions will not pass. After seeing the question, if you're sure of the answer, you can say power play and then give your answer. In which case you stand a chance to make 15 points if you get it right. However, if you say power play and get the answer wrong, you'll get a minus 8. If you don't say power play and just give me an answer, you will get the regular 10 points with no negatives. All right. We will start with the ascending order of scores. So we will first go to Anvi and ask her to pick a topic. This round is a little tough. The questions may be a little tough, but I will give you more clues. Okay. So Anvi, just pick a topic. Business, landmark, miscellaneous, trophy, television, dam age, flag, magic, Augustus.
Television.
Television. Okay. Television. Okay. On June 25th, 1951, CBS, an American TV network, broadcast the very first commercial color TV program. This first color program was a variety show and reached 4 cities. An appropriate name was picked for the show, a word that is also used in the context of movies. What was this TV program called? Whenever a movie is going to be released, right? The very first show or a special show the day before the actual release is also known by the same word.
Trailer.
Sorry?
Trailer.
I can't quite hear you. Can you say that again?
Trailer.
Trailer. Trailer. Okay, nice guess. Nice guess. It's not trailer though. Anybody else wants to try? Sir. Yes, Aditya.
Sir, it's premiere.
Premiere is correct. It is premiere. It's called a premiere show and this thing was also called a premiere. Okay. Next question. Next chance is to Karmanpreet. What topic would you like, Karmanpreet? Television is done. So pick something else.
Magic.
Magic. Okay, magic. The Merlin Award for the best magicians in the world is named after the legendary Merlin from the stories of King Arthur. The statue for the prize depicts a basic magic trick. What magic trick is shown in the statue for the Merlin Award? Think about a common magic trick that we typically talk about when we describe magicians. You typically say that this magician managed to do a particular act, right? So it's also like a phrase in English. So what does it refer to? What trick does it refer to? Sorry?
Any image with it.
There is no, the image will be the answer. So you will have to think about it and tell me like a phrase that would kind of indicate what the answer is and what the statue looks like. Or tell me, okay, let me put it this way. There are two key objects, okay, in the statue. What are the two key things that you will find in the statue? You will, okay, I will make it even easier for you. You will find one, the representation of an animal and the and an object in the statue. Just tell me an animal and an object.
So animal will be pigeon.
A pigeon, okay. And the object?
Hat.
Hat, okay. Very nice guess. You were on the right track. It is not pigeon and hat. Let's see if anybody wants to make a guess at the answer.
So can I try?
Sir? Sankarshan, try.
Sir, it is a rabbit and a hat.
A rabbit and a hat is right. So like pulling a rabbit out of a hat, you typically say a magician pulls a rabbit out of a hat. So you can see there that the award has a rabbit and a hat. Tough luck, Karmanpreet. You came close, but I can't give you part points. Sorry. So no points on that one. Bhavik will pick next.
Sir, flag.
Flag. Okay. Okay. Should be simple. The unique flag of this country has two triangular pennants. Pennants meaning the parts of the flag that you see there. The government says they stand for Hinduism and Buddhism. However, originally it stood for something found in that country, which is very, you know, large and very famous. What is this triangular thing supposed to represent?
Sir, the Buddha temple.
Don't rush into an answer. Please read the question, right? Like I said, it does not stand for Hinduism or Buddhism. It stands for something large found in that country, which is very famous. Right? So it has nothing to do with religion. So you have to probably, like, for example, turn this flag around in one direction and look at it and think about what is it that it could be. You have to also obviously figure out which country this is.
Yes, sir. This is Nepal and it stands for mountain ranges.
Which mountain range specifically?
Sir, Himalayas.
That is the correct answer, Bhavik. That is the correct answer. This time I'll allow you a little bit of leeway there. Because you rushed into that answer. This is indeed the Himalayas, right? So the peaks, those triangular pennants are supposed to stand for the peaks of the mountains in the Himalayas. So that gets you 10 points. And we will ask Chinmay to pick the next question.
Sir, trophy.
Trophy. All right, trophy. Okay. The winner of the Masters tournament in a particular sport is shown here with the trophy. Look at how the trophy looks like and tell me what the sport is. It is an indoor sport. It is an indoor sport in which typically the balls in the sport are arranged in that particular formation that you see there, very similar to the trophy that he is holding up. If you are very sure of the answer, you can say power play and give me the answer. Otherwise, you can just give me the answer as it is. Which indoor sport is this?
Sir, power play pool.
Power play, and you're saying pool. Can you give me a slightly better answer?
Sir,
Think about it. You said pool. You're not wrong altogether. I just need a slightly better answer than pool, if you can. If you do that, I'll give you the full 15 points. Otherwise, I will...
A power play.
No, no, hold on. Aditya, please wait. It's still Chinmay's turn. Please keep yourself on mute. Okay, I think I'll give you the points. It's fine. Because the term pool is kind of sometimes used in a broader classification as well. And more importantly, I think this particular set is used in pool as well. So we'll give you the points. The more specific answer we were looking for was snooker, right? For snooker, but pool, I think, is fair enough for points. So 15 points to you for saying pool. That is correct. Next is Sankarshan's turn.
Sir, I'll go with business.
Business, all right. Okay. Alfred Fielding and Mark Chavanes in 1957 were working on a new type of wallpaper. For this, they laminated two plastic sheets with small air packets trapped in between. Though their invention was a failure as interior decoration, the new material was lightweight and had very useful insulating properties. So today you will find this material in a lot of packaging. So typically if you order something from, say, Amazon or Flipkart or whatever, the packaging will come with this type of material. And as an additional clue, a lot of people enjoy playing with this material as well, right? Once it comes in a package. So what is this material? We're looking for a two-word answer. So it is typically used as a covering material. It has very good insulating properties. So it's used as a covering material. So typically if you order something a little fragile or if you order something, consumable and so on, you will typically get it wrapped in this material.
Sir, I know that it is a packet. It has bubbles in it and we burst them.
Okay.
But I'm not...
You've given me part of the answer already. So just complete your answer.
Sir, I'll go with bubble packets.
It's fine. I'll give it to you. I would not have given it to you on a power play, but on a regular one, I'll give it to you. The specific name is bubble wrap, but you described it correctly that, this is how it looks. And typically everybody likes, even older people like squashing the bubbles and playing with it. Bubble packaging is close enough for you to get to the answer. So I'll give it to you on bubble packaging or bubble wrap. 10 points to Sankarshan. Sifat, it's your turn. You have 4 options left.
So I'd like to go with Augustus.
You'll go with Augustus, all right. The memorial park at this site is retained like this, with the building seen in the background looking dilapidated. This is to remind people of the horror of what had taken place in this city and at this site. What horrific event commemorated on 6th August every year? Let's see the picture. So this is a memorial park and you can see that the buildings are all kind of destroyed and ruined and so on. But they have kept it like this so that everybody remembers of the destruction that happened because of this horrific event that happened on 6th August about more than 70 or let me say, yeah, more than 70 years ago.
So I know that on this day, some Pope was actually killed, but I don't remember his name.
But think about the fact that buildings and all have been destroyed. I'll give you an additional clue that this location is in Asia. It's in an Asian country. It is one of the most horrific, horrible things that has happened in the world, in world history. It resulted in lots of buildings being destroyed and lots of people being killed.
Sir, power play.
Aditya, please.
Sir, Aditya, power play.
Yeah.
Hiroshima and Nagasaki.
Okay, Sifat, you said power play. I need only one answer. Where will you find this?
So Hiroshima.
Hiroshima. And what happened in Hiroshima?
Sir, over here the bombing happened.
That is the right answer, Sifat. Well done. This is indeed Hiroshima, right? This is Hiroshima Day, 6th August 1945, where the atomic bomb was dropped. And 3 days later, of course, on 9th August, it happened at Nagasaki. And so this is commemorated as Hiroshima Day. This is the Atomic Peace Memorial Dome in Hiroshima. And it is still left, you know, little dilapidated to remind people of the this thing. Aditya, the questions don't pass, okay? So no point in you saying power play to other people's questions. Questions in this round do not pass, okay? So just chill. If nobody answers it for non-compete, for no points, I'll come to one of you, all right? But good 15 points to Sifat. She played a power play well. I think that leaves us with two contestants and three questions. So, Aditya, time for you to make a pick.
So, landmark.
Landmark. Okay, landmark to you. Easy one. Among the fascinating pieces of trivia about this landmark include the fact that it has a 35-foot waistline, 25 windows in the crown, and wears the size 879 shoe. The makers also found a way to represent the seven seas and the seven continents on this landmark. Which very, very famous landmark, not in India, but in a very important country in the world, are we talking about? Remember the fact that it has a waistline, it has a crown, and so on. So think about what type of structure it would be. And it is something that all of us have seen many, 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 many times. It is one of the world's most famous structures of its kind.
So, it's a power play, Statue of Liberty.
Perfect. Take your 15 points. Well done. This is indeed the Statue of Liberty. The crowns, etc., were the clues. The spikes, if you notice the Statue of Liberty, there are seven spikes that radiate from the Statue of Liberty on the top of the crown, and those are supposed to represent the seven seas or the seven continents. Okay, well done. Nicely answered. Last question of this round is a chance for Sarakshi to catch up with Aditya. Do you want miscellaneous or do you want damn age?
Miscellaneous.
Miscellaneous, okay. Okay. Among the lesser known ones are the International Tchaikovsky Competition, the International Congress on Mathematical Education, and the World Congress of Soil Science. Among the better known ones are the Men's Hockey World Cup, Copa America in football, and the election of US state governors. I can also add even the Men's Football World Cup and the Men's 50 over Cricket World Cup as well. So as you can see, all of these are events. Take a very simple guess. We have left out some very, very famous examples from this. Just tell me what is common to all these events. You can see that these are various different types of events that happen in different parts of the world. So the commonality is not with a person or a country or whatever. It's just a very simple commonality. So Men's Hockey World Cup, Men's Football World Cup, Men's Cricket World Cup, Copa America tournament in football, the election of US state governors. The International Congress on Mathematical Education. All these, what is common to all of them? Think very simple. We have left out one very famous example from the world of sports. And one very current example from the world of politics. Which if I give you, it will become very easy. So don't overthink, think simple. Like I said, one very famous example from the world of sports and one very famous example, which is very current news from the world of politics, we have left out. If you add those two also, then you'll be able to easily figure out what the commonality among all these could be.
Is it something like they all include just males?
They all include just males. No, that is not quite correct, Sarakshi. I think there are several women state governors as well in the US, and those international events definitely don't include only males. It's a much simpler answer. The two things that I could have included are the Olympics and the US presidential elections. Now, do you want to make another guess on what the commonality could be? A very simple commonality. Once I include the Olympics and the US presidential elections. Does anybody want to guess? Okay, someone make a guess. Come on.
So can I try?
Yeah, who's that?
Sankarshan.
Yes, Sankarsh. Go ahead.
They have rings on their flags.
Good guess again. Not rings on their flags. Much simpler than that. No? All right. Let's see what the answer is. Very simple answer. All these happen once in 4 years. That's all we wanted. All these are events that happen once in 4 years. As simple and straightforward as that. Okay. Sometimes it's the simple questions which become very tricky. Okay. I think that ends the round. We'll do another quick score check and go into the final round. We are a little behind schedule. We need to speed it up. Okay, scores at this point, Anvi and Karmanpreet are yet to open. Bhavik is on 15. Sankarsh is on 20. Chinmay and Sifat are on 25. Again, jointly in third place. Sarakshi is on 40. But with that power play in that round, Aditya is in the lead with 55. Okay, no worries. 12 more questions to go. Let's go to the anti-clockwise round. Same rules as before, except that we will start with Sifat this time and we'll go in reverse order. Right. So, Sifat, this is your direct. In 2016, 17 building projects from many countries were selected as a collective UNESCO World Heritage Site. These included notable buildings like Kruchet House in Argentina, Imbeul Clarté in Switzerland, and the Maison Gouet in Belgium. All of these had one person, a very famous person, as the connecting thread because he had kind of designed or architected all these buildings. Which was the only site that was chosen from India? So 17 building projects from various countries were collectively chosen as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Which was the only one of these from India? Again, there is a reason why we are asking this question. And the person who is the person involved in all of these buildings is someone very well known to all of us. Especially to all of you.
So I'm not sure of this answer, but can I guess?
Yeah, please go ahead. Make a guess.
So the Vishwanathan temple.
The Kashi Vishwanath temple, you mean? Okay, no, not the Kashi Vishwanath temple. Passes to Sarakshi.
Chandigarh High Court.
And who's the person? Who's the person who could have kind of designed or architected all of these? Sorry?
I don't really remember that.
Say your guess again. And your answer is the Chandigarh High Court, is it?
Yes.
I'll give it to you. Even though it's not exact, you've gotten to most of the essential part. It's the Chandigarh Capital Complex, which includes the High Court and the Secretariat and so on. Le Corbusier, of course, the great architect who designed and developed large parts of Chandigarh, the city that all, if not many of you live in, I presume. But he's of French origin and he's also architected or designed several buildings across the world. So it's a very unique UNESCO World Heritage Site containing buildings from various countries. And the addition from Chandigarh was the Chandigarh Capital Complex. But Chandigarh High Court is part of that. So I will give it to you and I didn't ask for Lee Corbusier, though I would have expected you to know that. 10 points to Sarakshi.
Yes, sir. Sir, I was saying that I actually knew the full answer. Next turn.
That's fine. That's okay. A key points came out. It's your question now, Sankarsh. It's your direct. Okay. What similar endurance records in Test cricket are held by the two people seen here? Use the numbers as a clue. So you'll see two famous cricketers and two numbers. Just tell me what those numbers mean. Okay. There you go. Famous Indian, famous Sri Lankan. So against the Indian's name, it says 31,528. And against the Sri Lankan's name, it says 44,039.
Sir, I think it is the number of hours or minutes that total matches that they have played.
Number of hours or minutes of the total matches they have played. Okay. Nice guess, but not right. Karman, your guess?
Sir, I think runs.
Runs. No, it's nothing to do with runs. Chinmay?
No, sir, I don't.
Don't know. Bhavik?
Sir, matches played.
Matches played. No, certainly not 31,000 matches. No. Anvi?
No, I don't know.
Okay. Aditya?
Excuse me, sir.
Aditya, please make a guess.
Sir, Rahul Dravid is the ball number of balls played.
Oh. And on the right?
And the Murli, I think I am not sure for the full name. He balls bold, sir.
Perfect answer. Good enough. I'll give it to you. Rahul Dravid and Muthiah Muralidharan. Most balls faced and most balls bowled by a bowler. So most balls faced by a batsman in Test cricket over his career is Rahul Dravid. You can see 31,000 and odd balls. So if you divide that by 6, you can see that he has faced nearly 5,000 overs of batting over the 150 odd Test matches that he has played. And 51,000 balls, so which means like 8,000 plus overs bowled by Muralidharan, who's the highest wicket taker in the world as well with 800 wickets. Good answer, Aditya. 10 points to you. Question to Sifat. All of you, once again, please keep your hands in front of camera all the time so that we can see them clearly. Okay. Sifat, should be an easy question for you. Most people would have come across only a few varieties of this yummy thing, but there are nearly 50 of them, including Capellini, Buktani, Ditalini, Gigli, Fusilli, and so on. Each one is named after a shape. The common variety known to all of us comes from the Latin word for string-like. What food item are we talking about? And what is the one that is named for string or string-like? Question to Sifat.
So with string, I can relate to noodles, but I'm not sure.
So what is your final guess?
So I think noodles, I think.
Noodles. No, not noodles. Passing you to Sarakshi.
Is it types of pasta?
And?
Is it pasta?
And what's the second part? Which is the famous one that you know that's named after string or which looks like string-like?
Spaghetti.
That is the right answer. Well done, Sarakshi. Well worked out. This is types of pasta. There are nearly 50 types of pasta. we're probably familiar with only four or five, you know, when we go to most restaurants or make it at home, spaghetti, fettuccine, and so on. But there are about 50 types. There was fusilli over there, which should have also been clue. So there's something called farfal, which is designed like a, the shape resembles a butterfly. So it's called farfal and so on. So pasta and spaghetti is right. 10 points to Sarakshi. Sankarshan's question. You're going to go a little fast. Okay. Abanindranath Tagore, the nephew of Rabindranath Tagore, evolved a new style of painting known as the Bengal school. His main source of inspiration is said to be the artwork seen inside a place that was discovered accidentally by a British officer named John Smith. The John Smith was on a tiger hunt when he came upon this place. This is today a very famous tourist location in India. It's a UNESCO World Heritage Site as well. What is this place full of art that inspired Abanindranath Tagore?
Sir, I think it is the Ajanta Caves.
That is the right answer. You think right. That gets you 10 points. As simple as that. This is the Ajanta Caves in Maharashtra. Ajanta and Ellora Caves near the about 100 kilometers from the town of Aurangabad, where you can find these wonderful frescoes on the caves. And Abanindranath Tagore was inspired by this. 10 points to Sankarshan. Question to Karmanpreet. Karmanpreet, come on. Answer this because I would like you to be able to open your account. The four stars and four stripes on the flag of Comoros, a country off the coast of Africa, represent what geographical aspect of the nation? So why are there four stars or four stripes? In both cases, the logic or the answer is the same. Remember that it's a tiny country and it is off the coast of Africa. So think about what type of geographical formation is this country, and then make a guess. Since it lies off the coast, it is not in the main part of Africa, it is off the coast. So think about what type of geographical word could be used to describe a country like this, and then make a guess as to why there are four stars or four stripes.
Sir, I think it's an archipelago, okay. Or we can say islands.
Islands. And why are there, why are there four stripes or four stars? Take a simple logical guess now.
Comoro means four. Sir, I think directions east, west.
Directions north, south, east, west. Okay. All right. We'll pass you on to Chinmay. I haven't got the exact answer.
I think to show the religion, that is Islam.
No, nothing to do with the religion. Passes to Bhavik.
I think it is made of four islands.
That's all it was. As simple as that. The country is made up of four islands, right? So therefore, it is there are four stripes or four stars over there. I'm going to give you 5 points though, Karmanpreet, because you said islands, which is a key part of the answer. But you said that Comoros means four or northeast, west, south, both of which were good guesses. But the correct answer is simply that it's the number of islands. So 5 points to Karmanpreet and the full 10 points to Bhavik on this one. Question now goes to Anvi. Anvi, Normandy in France saw the inauguration of the first ever dash-dash road in 2016. This road is called Whatways and it was opened on the RD5 road by the ecology minister Ségolène Royal. What are these Whatways? I'll show you a useful picture. Take a look. Yeah, you can see the minister inaugurating this road. It's a very special type of road. And there is a reason why it is called Whatways, W-A-T-T-W-A-Y-S. Simply tell me, what is this road all about? What is so special about this road?
Because it goes in all the ways.
No, look at the visual carefully. Look at the minister standing on this road. Look at the base of this road, how it looks, what do you think is shown there? And tell me, why is this so special? Various countries are going to start trying to build roads like this from here on. Because it's
so can you show the question again?
Yeah, we'll go back to the question again. Or you can simply tell me, what do you see in the picture on the road?
So it's a footpath.
What type of footpath? I mean, what is it that is actually on that surface?
It's in the shape of bricks.
Nothing to do with the shape of bricks. I'll pass you on to Aditya.
Sir, it's made of solar panel.
It's made of solar panels. As simple as that. That's all I wanted. It's made of solar panels, or these are solar powered roads. That's why it's called watt ways, because these roads are expected to actually generate electricity from the solar panels that are there. So they made it in such a way that there are solar panels on the road, but the road is also motorable by vehicles, and the electricity generated from there will power various things, including, in an illustrative example that you can see there, possibly the traffic lights and so on. So nice answer, simple answer there. Well done, Aditya. You get 10 points for solar panels. Question goes back to Sifat. Okay, Sifat. Leif Erikson was a Viking explorer who lived between 970 and 1020 AD. His most notable achievement is the establishment of a colony in what he called Vinland. Unknown to him, he was the first European to discover what? Lot of people think another famous European explorer is the first one to discover a particular landmark. But while he didn't know it at that time, he was the first European to discover what? Simple one-word answer. Everybody else thinks another famous, European was the first one to actually discover it.
So I think we've read it in Without Walls. Is this America?
America. That's all I wanted. Very simple. This is indeed America. Right? 10 points to you. He was the first person to set foot on continental North America. Much, much before Columbus arrived here in 1492. Right? Okay. That's a good 10 points to Sifat. Sarakshi, your question. This fictional character was described in this book, in this famous children's book that we've all read, in this manner. Everybody knew him. Nobody dared to cross his path. He was as cunning as Tabaqui, as bold as the wild buffalo, and as reckless as the wounded elephant. The character who is a particular type of animal has a name that is the Urdu word for that animal. Which character and what type of animal is he? Like I said, it's a very famous children's book. It's been made into films as well. We've all, read the book, seen the films. And this is like an important and, I would say, a bit of a fun character in this book. The book is also set in India. It's written by an Englishman, but set in India. So if you get what type of animal it is, you should be able to easily tell me what's the name of the character.
The character is, I think, Bagheera.
Okay.
From
okay.
The Jungle Book.
Yeah.
And the character is a black panther.
10 points. Absolutely correct, Sarakshi. Perfectly correct. This is Bagheera, the black panther from Jungle Book. Absolutely right. This is how he was described, saying he's a very cunning and dangerous kind of character. But we know that he's quite a fun-loving character. Nicely done. Good 10 points to Sarakshi. Very close contest going on between Sarakshi and Aditya for top spot. But also close contest going on for second spot. So Sifat, Sankarsh, important question coming for you. Here's your direct. Sankarsh, since 1945, all armored vehicles in the British Army have this little device that runs on the vehicle's battery. It's believed that during wartime, soldiers became thick friends because of this device and what it is used for. Simply tell me, what is this used to prepare? While it doesn't look like it, what common thing is this used to prepare? The British are very fond of this. So what is this used to prepare?
Sir, it is used to prepare coffee.
Okay, I will unfortunately have to pass you to Karmanpreet.
Sir, can I try? No, just
sorry. If nobody comes close to the answer, then we'll see. Karmanpreet?
A compass needle?
Not a compass needle. Chinmay? Chinmay, you don't know. Passes to Bhavik.
I don't know, sir.
You don't know? Okay. Passes to Anvi. Come on, Anvi, you should answer this. If you just closely listen to what Sankar said, you can just make a guess.
It's used to boil things or heat them.
To make what finally?
To make
something very common that all of us are familiar with.
Juices.
No, you said boil and all, right? So you would boil and all to make what?
I don't know, milk.
Okay, what would you ultimately make if you did that?
I don't know. Milk, with milk we can make different things like cottage cheese?
No, not really. But you know what? I was just looking up something to double check. I'm going to actually close the question. I'm going to give the points to... Sankarsh because I don't think it's fair to pass it on. And I've just done some double checking. So he said, Sankarsh, what was your original guess?
Sir, I said coffee.
Yeah, and it's likely also probable that it's used to make?
Hot chocolate.
It's used to actually make tea, but tea and coffee. Okay, it is a boiling vessel, which is correct. It is actually called a BV or a boiling vessel. While it's largely used to make tea, I don't think it's wrong to say it's used to make coffee because we were not there around in the 1940s, or we are not there with the British Army to figure out what exactly they make. But largely, it is used to make coffee, and a couple of sources tell me that coffee or tea is fine. So I will be fair and I will give you the points on that. So it is used to make coffee or tea. So you get your 10 points. The next question now comes to Karmanpreet. Okay. Written by Dr. Seuss, the famous author, the book Lorax is a 1971 children's book that addresses economic and environmental issues caused by a particular activity. In 1995, the Hardwood Forest Association and the National Oak Flooring Manufacturers Association of USA came out with a kind of opposite book or a parody book called Truax. So what was the theme of Truax? So Lorax basically said, don't do something, right? It causes a lot of issues. And Truax was a kind of funny parody book, which kind of seemed to talk about the opposite of what Lorax said. So what is the theme of Truax?
So harvesting trees or cutting.
Cutting trees. Yeah. Okay. Cutting trees or logging trees. Yeah, that is the right answer. I'll give it to you. So Lorax basically said, don't cut down trees. It causes issues and so on. These guys who make wooden equipment and furniture and so on out of wood actually released a contrary book saying, no, it is important. We should log and cut trees. Right. So good. 10 points to you, Karman. Penultimate question of the quiz goes to Chinmay. Okay, Chinmay, this sport will be making its debut in the Olympic Games, which are going to happen hopefully in 2021 at Tokyo. There will be two events, kumit, meaning meeting of hands, and kata, which means shape. Developed a few hundred years ago in the Ryukyu kingdom, which sport are we talking about? It may have been a demonstration sport earlier, but it's going to make its debut as a medal sport in this Summer Olympics. Remember that the Olympics are going to happen in Tokyo, scheduled for last year. Of course, as we all know, the pandemic pushed it out to 2021.
Skateboarding.
Good guess, not skateboarding. Bhavik?
Sir, kendo.
Sorry, what?
Sir, kendo.
Kendo, not kendo. Good guess again. Passes to Anvi.
Karate.
Say again, Anvi.
Karate.
Karate. Very good, Anvi. Good answer. So finally, I'm glad that, you've managed to score off the 11th question of the anti-clockwise round. This is indeed karate. Absolutely right. Well done. Good. I am usually very sad and disappointed if any contestant ends up with no points at the end of a quiz, because I know that, it's a little bit of a luck factor involved as well. There may be questions to which you know the answers which don't come to you, but I'm glad you scored points. Okay, last question coming up. Very tight contest. So the question will go direct to Aditya. I think if he answers it, he definitely wins the quiz. And then we'll see what happens on the pass. Even the second place is, the third place is also in a close contest at the moment. Okay, Aditya, here's your question. Ithaca, New York declared itself a free-range kid city in November 2018. This gave parents and kids a certain right. In a normal setting, this would result in calls to the police and US state authorities taking action against the parents and so on. But after this law has been passed, kids can demand this and the parents have the right to grant it. What is this right, or what is it that parents can allow or kids can ask for, which I'm sure many of you probably enjoy? Whereas in the US, these laws are very strict till a certain age, right? But Ithaca, which is a part of New York, which is like a county in New York, has actually declared itself a free range city. So what does this mean? There is no technical term or anything in the answer. You just have to describe it. Describe it and tell me what it means.
So, I think they can go out in unsupervised time alone.
Say again?
They can go out alone without their parents at any time or unsupervised time.
Perfect. Perfect answer, Aditya. Great answer. Absolutely correct. So, they are allowed to go out or go around without their parents, unsupervised, whenever they want to. It's something that... we all take for granted here, but in the US, it's not so easy. Parents are supposed to be responsible for their kids and supervise them all the time. But Ithaca has allowed the right to unsupervised time. Great answer. I think that ends the quiz on an appropriate note. Well, let's take a look at the final scores now. And I think we've avoided tie breaks. Okay, we have Anvi who finished with 10 points. Well done, Anvi. We have Karmanpreet who finished with 15 points. Well done. We have Bhavik and Chinmay who both finished with 25 points. Good answers. Some good answers from both of you. Chinmay answered 2 questions right. Bhavik actually got 3 questions right. Well done. Then in a very close finish for third place. In fourth place, we have Sifat with 35 points. Having answered 3 questions. Good. Well done, Sifat. Congratulations to you. In third place today, we have Sankarshan, who answered 4 questions and finishes with 40 points. So, Sankarshan, which house are you?
Tulip House.
Okay. So, Sankarshan, Tulip House, finishes third place with 40 points. Our runner-up today with some wonderful answers, probably some of the questions she knew did not come to her. She got a sum total of 7 answers correct. With 70 points is Sarakshi. Sarakshi, congratulations. Which house do you represent?
Orchid House.
Orchid House. So wonderful. Tulip in third place. Orchid House, Sarakshi Sharma in runners-up place. But winning the quiz by answering 8 questions correct and doing a power play on one of them is Aditya Goel with 85 points, who's our winner. And Aditya, which house do you represent? Aditya? Sorry, which house are you in?
We're in Orchid.
You're in Orchid as well. Okay, great. So I think that concludes our quiz. We have Tulip in third place and Orchid House taking first and second place. Aditya Goel, the winner, Sarakshi Sharma, the runner-up, and Sankarshan, the third place, with Sifat in fourth place. So well done. Thank you all very much. That's the end of the quiz.